America, and other free and open societies face crucial challenges and opportunities abroad that affect security and prosperity at home. This is a series of conversations with guests who bring deep understanding of today's battlegrounds and creative ideas about how to compete, overcome challenges, capitalize on opportunities, and secure a better future. I am H.R. McMaster. This is Battlegrounds.
On today's episode of Battlegrounds, our focus is on Europe and the country of Poland, a committed NATO and American ally. Our guest, General Rajmund Andrzejczak, is Chief of the General Staff of the Polish Armed Forces. General Andrzejczak has served in the Polish military for over three decades and was nominated to the rank of General in 2019. He is the recipient of the Order of the Second Class Military Cross, Commander's Cross, Star of Iraq, and Star of Afghanistan. He is a graduate of the Military Academy of the Armed Forces in Poznan, the Defense Academy of the Czech Army, the National Defense Academy in Warsaw, and the Royal College of Defense Studies in London. Poland is located between historically major powers, with a lack of natural borders that allowed for frequent military attacks. Between 1772 and 1795, Austria, Russia, and Prussia partitioned Poland three times until the state was wiped off the map. The Polish state did not arise again until the end of World War I, when the Allies demanded its rebirth in the 1919 Treaty of Versailles. Following World War I, in 1920, the Polish army in Warsaw held off a Soviet westward offensive in the battle known as the Miracle on the Vistula. In 1939, Nazi Germany signed the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact with the Soviets, a non-aggression agreement to allow yet another partition of Poland. On September 1, 1939, Hitler began World War II with the Blitzkrieg invasion of Poland. 17 days later, the Soviet Union invaded Poland from the east, and 17 days after, Poland lost its independence again. During the brutal Nazi and communist occupation, Poland suffered some of the highest civilian casualties in the war. Nazi Germany pursued industrial-style genocide in the territories under its control and established a network of death camps, including Auschwitz and Treblinka, within Poland. At the same time, Stalin masterminded the elimination of Polish elites, including the massacre of thousands of Polish officers in the forests near Katyn. Yet despite their military defeat, Poles, led by their government in exile in London, sided with the Allied powers and formed underground resistance movements against the Germans. The most famous and tragic action was the 1944 Warsaw Uprising, which failed after weeks of fighting, due in part to purposeful lack of Soviet support. Post-World War II, Poland fell under Soviet domination. The country's borders were redrawn at the Potsdam Conference, redistributing much of the eastern land to the Soviets. In 1947, Poland became a Communist People's Republic after Soviet rigged elections. The unsuccessful anti-Stalinist protests of 1968 by students and intelligentsia prompted the government's repression of dissident movements shortly thereafter. By 1970, widespread protests, fueled by spikes in food price and the deterioration of the Polish economy, engulfed the country. In the 1980s, the opposition to the communist rulers united. The intellectuals joined hands with the workers, giving rise to the Solidarity Trade Union, a Catholic-inspired movement to protect workers. Afraid of losing control, the communist government, supported by Moscow, imposed martial law in December 1981. But a few years later, due to the persistent opposition of the vast majority of the population, deeply rooted in the Catholic faith, the communists were forced to negotiate partially free elections, which in 1989 resulted in a coalition government. Soviet control over Central Europe unraveled. By 1993, all Soviet troops left Poland, with the last forces leaving on September 18th, a symbolic date given the Soviet invasion of the country on September 17th, 1939. Polish President Lech Walesa the former leader of the Solidarity Trade Union, watched them leave and announced that law, freedom, and democracy had won. In 1999, Poland joined NATO, and its forces participated in the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. Poland remains a strong NATO ally in the face of growing threats. We welcome General Andrzejczak to discuss the U.S.-Poland relationship and security challenges, including an increasingly aggressive Russia, energy security, and transnational terrorism.
General Andrzejczak, welcome to Battlegrounds. It is good to host a fellow cavalry officer. Thank you for joining us at what I know is a very busy time for you and the Polish Armed Forces to help us understand better the security situation in Europe.
Hello. Hello, HR, and hello for everybody. Really, it's busy time, full of challenges, but living in Poland here in a very unique strategical geolocation is very important. So it's a big pleasure and honor for me to be here and to get a chance to present some Polish perspective of security. So hello for everybody.
Rajmund, I thought I'd begin with a general question for a general officer. I thought maybe you could help explain the Polish perspective on international security based on Poland's 1,000-year historical experience, geography, and the fact that today Poland is again on the eastern front of an increasingly dangerous competition with Russia.
Well, yeah, it is. So 1,000 of history and a very unique location matters for us. And when I'm circulating and talking to my counterparts and presenting my point of view, I see very often that we're looking in today's situation in a very short perspective, not keeping in mind that the geostrategy and history matters. So first of all, a very important relation Poland and the United States we have is a critical. So historically, it's not like a last couple of decades, and not only since the Iraqi or Afghanistan war. So historically, the point is symbolically, it's 1772 is the point where we lost independence. And we lost independence for 123 years. Since that point, cooperation and relation, I mean, Poland and the United States, always very, very important. So 1772 is also important date in the history of the United States. So although we lost our independence and we disappeared from a map, a lot of Polish patriots and warriors, commanders were very, very active everywhere. So there's no doubts that the Kościuszko and Pułaski, I know that will be very difficult pronunciation for Americans. But when I was in Washington and I saw a statue of Kościuszko and Pułaski, I said, well, that's very important, the Polish patriots and soldiers fighting for independence. And then understanding of a situation after 123 years, when we were about to go back to the map, and support of President Wilson and his commitment in the political processes to regain independence and you know, all of the things, again, back to Poland, to the map, also very well recognized in Poland and appreciated. President Reagan, Cold War, and President Bush, when we started joining to NATO, and also our commitment in Iraq and Afghanistan, that's the piece of history you and me, we know pretty well. And so the relation between Poland and the United States historically is very, very tight and very, very important. Before we go to assessment of security, also very important to mention, it's the U.S. contribution and the security right now in Poland. We have installations, we have a permanent presence here, we have really good modernizational programs, so enough reasons to stay close and to build security environment. But now, today, HR, we're living in a completely different dimension that in the history context. So new strategical conditions, they were very important, starting from 1991. 3 decades of prosperity and permissive economical cycle is over. Globalization is in the question mark. Russia is back to the table. There's no better place to discuss right now in Poland. we have all of the dynamics we see and we're tracking and we're discussing the US pivot to Pacific, which is understood because the competition with China. And we have a lot of points of discussion concerning energy and everything what we put to the box called Eastern policy for Poland, for Eastern flank, for European Union, NATO, and Western society, which is Belarus and Ukraine. So that's the general review.
Yeah, that's a great introduction. I'd like to talk with you about each of those topics. And I thought maybe to start off, you might give us your assessment of how well the U.S. and NATO and Poland are all working together under the context of this European Deterrence Initiative. But I also would love to hear just more about your experience in a huge transition in the Polish Armed Forces from 1991. I think I told you earlier, I was in the 2nd Armored Cavalry Regiment on the border of East and West Germany when East Germany lifted travel restrictions to the West. And then we saw the East German government fade away and the Soviet Union break apart and usher in a profoundly new era. And you've helped lead across your career a massive transformation in the Polish Armed Forces. And might you share some of that experience and then your assessment of how the U.S., NATO, and Poland are working together now to deter Russian aggression on really, I think, a new frontier, a new Eastern Front in the confrontation with Russia.
Yeah, Eastern Front. It's not a nice word, and we'll explain a bit. Yeah, really, it's 1991. It was a historical point for many reasons. You know it from a periscope of your M1. Tank and a fine intel account division, and I was promoted to second lieutenant. And being young commander, always for very focusing on the short tactical perspective. And then you're growing up, and now I'm sitting in my office and I try to see last three decades, but also in the context of a historical background, which is more or less 1,000 years of history of Poland. Everything changed, everything completely. So when I remember myself in 1991, it was a structure, culture, tactics, and equipment, and everything was completely different. I started my deployments being on the Golan Heights in the beginning as a contingent commander, but then I was together with the U.S. Army in Iraq and Afghanistan. And that was the point where we started our very close cooperation. So for me, the active Fifth Corps command post right now in Poland is natural. So we know for many years how we operate, but the dimension of 1991, when there was really no Soviet Union anymore, and there was no China yet, it was completely different situation. So in Poland, active dialogue concerning how to improve capability, the relations, how to invest properly, fast and effective enough. As I mentioned, the Fifth Corps, we have a divisional elements, we have an army brigade combat team, aviation, we have new regulations, ADCA, which is the big investments of Poland to permanent presence of the U.S. Army. And also very important for me is the direction of modernization of the Polish Armed Forces. So fifth generation airplane, F-35s, we will be the only country on the Eastern flank having such a capability. Also the long range artillery, which matters, building deterrence and defense systems and building strategic dilemma for the other side of the hill. And also air defense, which is getting more and more important today, including the U.S. Patriot systems. So we have plenty of platforms for discussion, as well as strategic discussion in the frame of NATO right now. So we know exactly, Poles, that the role of Poland here as a strategical hub in this region is absolutely critical. We approaching to our geostrategical location, first of all, with a huge responsibility. So we feel the responsibility of Poland and our armed forces to build this dimension. So really, for me, last three decades is a completely different dimension. So Russia is back to the table. Russia is making troubles, very, very active, directly or using another players. So HR for you, we just have a very, very hot border with Belarus, which there's no question about is Russian design. We have a very complicated situation in the Ukrainian-Russian border, which is our neighbor, and a lot of things to be done. So we cannot do it alone, and relation with the United States is absolutely, absolutely critical.
Could you talk a little bit more about that, the threat from Russia, and you mentioned dimensions of it already, but it spans across Europe and beyond, right, from the Baltics and what you've seen on your eastern border with these massive Zapad exercises to Belarus, and you alluded already to this weaponization of migrants at your border, to the Black Sea, and of course the menacing mobilization of forces we see along the border of Ukraine and in Crimea, and the ongoing war there. And what do you think Vladimir Putin wants, and how concerned are you? And what more do you think NATO might do to deter conflict with Russia?
Right. The HR, let's go through last three decades, what really happened. Sometimes people say we are very overreactive and, you know, the Russophobic, being Polish. But I would say, let's go with no emotions, just only facts. So this is 1991. And we look in the situation, the first Chechnya war, you know, using military instruments of power, you know, in a kind of a discipline for, Russian neighbors. Then we have a second Chechnya war. That was the time window when the Poland joined NATO, was completely, you know, changing the dimension. Then we have, of course, 9/11 war in Afghanistan, Iraq. So Russia, in the perception, disappeared. There was an implosion, a lot of political, you know, problems, and economical and so on. And then, after the NATO summit, there's a Russian invasion in Georgia. So there's no question about how they're making policy around. Mostly it will be implementing military instruments of power. And then all story begins. It's the Crimea in 2014, and we see the Russian troops in Syria with the much bigger strategical range. We see a very active training cycle very close to the Polish border, NATO borders, Zapad 17, and was last time the Zapad 2020. Then we have plenty of gray zone operations. So Navalny, the Belarusian crisis designed and fueled by Russians. That we have the Karabakh crisis. We have new domains like solar winds, cyber attacks, and elections, infiltrations. There was a changing in the Russian constitutional system, which gives Putin power forever. We have the nuclear policy, unclassified, presented for us. That is very aggressive explanation how to use nuclear assets.
Concept of escalation domination, right, and essentially threatening Europeans with first use of nuclear weapons as a way to blackmail the United States and to get others to sue for peace on Russia's terms. It's an extraordinarily destabilizing doctrine. But I just wanted to explain that quickly for our listeners. But this is a great rundown. Please continue, Raymond.
Yeah, and especially when you're living in Poland and have direct connections to the Kaliningrad Oblast, which is a huge militarized piece of Russia, including also the Iskander's missile system, it matters. So we see entire militarization programs of Kaliningrad. And last 2021, a lot of things, the Russian concentration, first time close to Ukrainian borders, leveraging the situation. We have a weaponizing of illegal migration, weaponizing of energy. We have a Ryanair airplane incident, forcing an airplane to land in Belarus, as well as a very aggressive posture in the Black Sea, not only in the Baltic, but also in the Black Sea, the HMS destroyer, as well as many others. So In the last three decades, we see that Russia is rebuilding military potential and using military instruments of power for projection and they're trying to change the order, global order, not respecting multinational law and relations. So for Poland, and it will be probably the very easy for you to understand, there's no space and no time. It's like a fill the gap situation right now. So we have to be ready today. We have to present our determination and not to be aggressive, but deterrence and defense in a very active approach is the only way to secure the country. We don't want to lose it for 123 years, like in a very, very bad time in history.
Raymond, I know a lot of these decisions are political, but what more do you think could be done, you know, to deter Russia at this point? I'm thinking, you know, we've talked a lot about economic sanctions in the past several weeks, and our Secretary of State is talking about relentless diplomacy. But as an armor officer, I'm thinking of an armored brigade, you know, in somewhere like Romania or Bulgaria might help that diplomacy and might augment those sanctions. And of course, I'm thinking of joint forces, including significant air capabilities as, again, a deterrent, right, within NATO countries. Is there anything like that under consideration? And what more do you think might be done to deter Vladimir Putin?
Yeah, it's exactly the very, very, you know, political questions, because we still are going along the Clausewitz rules, so the Trinity, the meaning of power, society, and army, and all of those relations still matters and is valid today. So war or any kind of conflict, crisis, whatever the military, today military vocabulary will react, new generation or hybrid. So the military actions always will be instruments of policy. So today we have in our interconnected world many instruments. Sanctions are one of them, and I think including the energy, technology, you know, trade, and so on. But I think the meaning of military instruments of power are still critical. So we can do everything possible in a nation state stage, and also there's a mission for Eastern Flank, for entire NATO, on Western society. So what I'm doing is heavily investing in the development of Polish army and any numbers, but also capability. So there's a huge support from my political masters, my president of Poland, my prime minister, minister of defense. Poles, they understand, they like army. So it means we have a very, very good conditions to build it. But of course, it costs money. It's a huge investment. We would rather pay and invest money for education, new technologies, not necessarily for security. But Russians, they're building a situation. There's no other option. So investments in army, as well as very close relations with the alliance. So the weakest point is a cohesion, is understanding situation from Warsaw, from another capitals in the Eastern Flank, but also from another countries. So that's one of the most important points right now, presenting our determination and our cohesion, and a proactive approach is absolutely critical. What the Poland is doing, We investing a lot of money, paying 2% GDP, even more, with the aspiration to pay much more for security. 100,000 regular forces, more, actually 113. Then we have territorial defense. So we're trying to, you know, design the system not only for conventional, but also for crisis management system. We're modernizing army, but also, which is absolutely critical, it's keeping as close as possible, talk, discuss, and build good relations. Alliance matters. So in Poland, we have bad experiences from the Second World War in the very beginning. So finding along is, it's not possible. So it matters for Poland. It's also the testament of Marshal Piłsudski. He said relations and the alliance matters. That's our direction we go.
I mean, you make a great point. I think it's deterrence is capability times will, right? And you're building your capabilities as much as you can. But we also need the will factor to be clear to the Russians or others who we wanted to deter from taking action or from using violence to achieve their objectives. You know, I wonder how you think NATO's doing in terms of the development of new capabilities in response to the growing threat from Russia. Of course, Russia has engaged in a number of modernization efforts. You mentioned the long-range fires capability, their tiered and layered air defense, the use of drones, and the reorganization of some of their armed forces into these, for example, these battalion tactical groups that have combined arms at lower levels. Could you say a little bit more about how you assess those changes in Russian capability and maybe place it in context of NATO capabilities and how you see us matching up?
Yeah, when I look at what the Russians are doing, it definitely is not defensive posture. So still investing in the nuclear capability, very mobile assets. We have huge discussion about the Iskander's calibers. They're presenting and they're communicating in Syria. They have such a capability and they really want to use it. We see brand new game changers, which is hypersonic technology, as well as changing structure to the divisional, from a brigade to divisional. It means much more mobile and much more offensive oriented. So there's no questions that this posture is not for defense approach. We also observing what they're doing in Syria and in Karabakh. Well, Kazakhstan is just recent Russian projection in using air assault. So what the NATO is doing right now is a composition between ACT and NCO. So a lot of good programs and the modernization, not only in the typical physical domains that we know very well, being cavalry officers, but also cyber, but also the something we're studying heavily in Poland is this cognitive warfare. So I see the tendency going from war of energy to the war of emotions. It always, historically, there was always, even in the Chinggis Khan time, that he used special units in the front to make the propaganda and going to the people's perception, the people's mind, but not so effective like today in info zone. But what is very important, we stopped for a while and there was a good refreshment. We said physical part of the army matters. So APCs, aircrafts, attack helicopters, and also tanks. So the definitely there's not end of the tanks anymore. We heard it many times in history, but today the balancing between the hard power and the soft power is very, very critical. And I'm just asking myself sometimes when we have some historical footprint or some points of reference, the second front, there was a Normandy, you know it very well, and there was a second front. So the first front was a Red Army going from east and the second front in the west. And I'm asking myself whether the cyber or perception, battle perception, is the first front today or second front. So maybe we have to recalibrate a little bit meaning or location of something what I called winning the first phase. First phase is the info, is the cognitive warfare, preventing containment to the propaganda. But in the end of the day, it's always nice to have three armored divisions to solve any kind of a problem. So balancing between the soft power and new dimensions, something what they call first front today, and in the end of the day, having hard power for deterrence and defense is absolutely crucial. So in NATO, we just woke up a little bit and said, okay, some of the countries, they don't have armor, they don't have heavy forces, ships, aircrafts. So last three decades, there was a very, very good time. But we are, relaxed too much. And in Poland, we are after two espresso right now. So definitely we know what's going on and investing very much in the security. Also,
as you mentioned, you know, Putin's strategy is also the use of these unconventional forces and capabilities under the cover of conventional and nuclear forces, and we have to match that, I think, with our own version of an integrated strategy. And I think what you're alluding to is a fundamental aspect of strategic competence, the ability to integrate all elements of power and efforts of like-minded partners to accomplish objectives. This Russian new generation warfare, in which Putin tries to accomplish objectives below the threshold oftentimes of what might elicit a military response, with disruption and disinformation and denial, as well as dependence, right? Building energy dependence, for example, I think is a very significant threat that affects, as you mentioned, our will, right? Our will to deter conflict and to ensure that Russia can't subvert national will and pit communities against each other and become more aggressive. So I wondered what your thoughts are on what more might be done across really all these elements of power, and in particular, maybe share your thoughts on the relationship between energy security and national security.
HR, any discussion we have here in Poland concerning strategy issues going to an energy point. So, the meaning of energy consumption for industry, for development of economy is absolutely crucial. So oil, gas, energy, electric energy is absolutely crucial. So it's a point to understand complexity of energy flow, and also how to secure in a combined way, not only military, but also the civilian contribution. So how to build something what we call the resilience of a state. The today resilience is extremely important as a huge contribution, but not necessarily in the dimension from the Cold War, a huge mobilization, big forces, and heavy fires. It's a composition of today battlefield, which includes the economy pressure. It's info, superiority that Russia tries to build. Not necessarily seizing territory, but controlling critical nodes, influencing, governance, alternative governance, corruption, riots, and finally going to the precise strikes in all domains in a very short conflict. So the compression of time factor today and the composition of civilian and military, light forces and air force heavy is absolutely the approach. And the for Poland, we understand our strategical location. So it means that between if you have a map, you see Russia on a map from Moscow across the Minsk, Brest. You're going to the Warsaw, then to Berlin, and across Europe to the. Across Atlantic, so it's a one big line of everything. It's a line of trade. It's a line of historically.
Highway. This is Highway One, right? Which is the.
This is our Highway One, the optic cables and everything. So historically, a couple of years ago, 1812, the history very well known in France. Then we had the Barbarossa, then the Bagration operation, and even today, when we look in the map. What's going on with the Russian scenarios of the Zapad, series of Zapad exercise, but also illegal migration. Everything is going that way, including energy, which is very, very important for Poland. The second line is horizontal and also the vertical lines. So linkage between Finland, Tallinn, Riga, Vilnius, going to the Warsaw and down to the Constanza and Romania is a crossroad of everything. So the energy is a critical concerning gas. We invested very much in the infrastructure, LNG terminals in Poland, and a lot of projects. So very soon we will be completely independent concerning gas, not depending on Russian supplies, which is very, very important, and probably they know it very well. And electrical energy is entire production is in Poland, but the biggest challenge, of course, is the carbon emission and the climate regulations in the European Union, but also in Poland. So we have to work much more, but also it gives us a lot of inspiration in army, how to secure in the peacetime those critical infrastructure, you know, reconnaissance, intelligence, you know, elements, the cybersecurity, but also physical, you know, force protection. And in the peacetime, in the crisis, which is new generation warfare, and finally also how to secure this infrastructure, the energy infrastructure during wartime, we expect will be very, very dynamic, very short. So the energy for economy, for security of the country, but as well for typical military activity, it's a lot of common points. So gas is really good, you know, investments. Oil, we're still working on it. And it leads us to the point, which is, of course, political in the dimension, which will be potentially nuclear, you know, power plants for green energy in the future. It will be good for economy, but of course it will be a nightmare for me to secure it. I'll be responsible as well for security. So always, you know, we have challenges.
I think the way I think about it is we can't afford any more non-solutions, right, to these interconnected problems of energy security and climate and carbon emissions and nuclear and natural gas as a bridge away from you know, the dirtier fossil fuels have to be part of that conversation. And I know Poland's right at the center of that in terms of your emphasis now on LNG exports, in part from the United States, as well as your emphasis on nuclear power. You know, economic competition is connected, obviously, to national security as well. And I think you're giving us a great lesson here on what geopolitics really means, because you're talking about the importance of geography, and you're giving us a lesson about what geoeconomics, a term that's often used, but I think little understood what that means as well in connection with energy security. I wonder if we might leave Europe and go a little bit even further to the east, to China. And I would love to hear your thoughts on the geopolitical and geoeconomic competition with China, especially now that we see China brandishing its coercive power against Lithuania, for example, as they have done against other countries in Europe. And where do you see the competition with China going from your perspective in Poland, and what is the Polish Armed Forces doing to prepare better for that geostrategic competition?
So, Jari, you'll be surprised how many times we're starting and discussing China and Poland. So it's not completely unknown topic, but it's very important for us to calibrate what it really means. So I always say, is that possible? Another fact to be very, very selfish and looking only in your region. So you have to understand all players of the game. So I'm trying to understand what's the scale of the China competition for US, because it still consume your assets, your capability. We have to keep in mind that it's extremely important what's going on in the far Pacific, in the Taiwan and entire region, Korea, Japan, Australia. So it's not like we don't discuss in Poland. However, it's for today, what we see right now, it's not easy to feel the Chinese contribution, but we expect them, especially concerning info security, the 5G technologies, the penetration in the systems, state system, but also in army. So the China is absolutely critical and important. What they're doing, human rights, they approach to the our standards. The very often I see some comparison between the Cold War and competition with the Soviet Union and the China. I not necessarily agree, but the differences, if you look in the competition between the United States or NATO and Soviet Union, Warsaw Pact, it was not about the economy. So Soviet Union was not competitor in economy. There was nothing in the culture. There was not finding ideology, maybe a little bit, but not necessarily. The Soviet culture was not so attractive and effective to influence the Western society. The same technology. Russia didn't have anything to present, and the US, security sanctions and limitations, there was no chance for Russians to use it, except, of course, illegal issues. and finance and so on. So the only area to for competition was army. China is different. So China is challenging it economically everybody in a very aggressive way. China is also challenging in the culture. So all of the institutes in Europe. So we see in the typical Sun Tzu approach. So time they get a time.
These are the Confucius Institutes, which we have in the United States as well, and exactly. Chinese students and scholars associations and various front organizations for their united front, right? Which is
exactly. So that's a completely different when you compare. It's not a Cold War, comparison, and the same technology. They're investing and challenging everybody, having pretty good economical presentation because the contracts they proposing are in a short time sometimes financially or economically attractive. So this is not is a much bigger scale, a much bigger threat in long term. It's not only for US, but also for everybody, entire Western society, how we approach it. So what I see what's going on right now in Australia and the investments in the security, we had a very good discussion with Hugh White, and one of his books was also translated to the Polish. And I wish I had your books translated to Polish. Anyway, so make some investments here. Will be, however, it is highly recommended for my general. So don't worry, they're reading in English. And so the China is a long-term the challenger, and probably it's not like we imagine right now that the Chinese tanks are going across to Europe. They will be, investing in the infrastructure, changing the flow of goods, and then finally they will decide where to go. What I see in Poland, one of the long-term threats will be Northern Road open. I mean, Arctics, the climate is climate change. When they finally open this road, which is more or less 10, 12 days shorter for business, for global business, is amazing factor. And then if they what I see, the Russians also investing in the Arctic capabilities. So again, everything from the White Sea across to Finland, across the Baltic states is going to the Poland. So we will be, again, in a strategical crossroads. So we observe China and assess, and I think it will be a huge economical, cultural, technological, financial, and a finally security challenger. It is, and it will be soon much more important.
Raymond, I saw Polish forces fight with great distinction in Iraq and in Afghanistan, and I saw them fight with particular distinction under your command in Ghazni in Afghanistan while I was there, I know it's been heartbreaking for all of us who've served there to see what's happened with the collapse in Afghanistan. I wonder if you might share your thoughts about the withdrawal and the collapse in Afghanistan, and maybe your thoughts on what the consequences might be and what concerns you about it.
Yeah, it's extremely difficult for me to assess because I still have a very, very emotional approach. So I love, seven Poles and also four American soldiers were under my command in the Ghazni province. So I still see that Afghanistan through the lens of our sacrifice and our, fighting for values, for everything which is important in life. Difficult to assess today. From some reasons, I say there were some points, to decide where to withdraw the troops. It's still a huge studies. Where point, what time, what scale or methodology was the most much more effective? So difficult to say. Well, what I'm afraid is we left the country with the situation. I have a bad feeling as someone who studied history of warfare, there will be some going back to this historical highways. So today everybody is focusing on COVID, and everybody is focusing what Russia is doing here, which is natural, especially for Poland, it's our neighbors. But in the long term perspective, if the situation in Afghanistan is not solved, they have no money, no effective governance. Finally, the people will start to leave and immigrate and go back to the Western Europe. So that's what's going on, what we see right now. We see immigration flow from Iraq, you know, Kurdistan. We see also Afghanis, many other terrorist organizations. So in the long-term perspective, we have to again sit down and discuss what's really going on. Who runs, who leads Afghanistan today? Nobody knows. So it's unresolved problem, and we will be soon that we expect back to the situation and facing the challenges pretty soon.
What bothers me is I think we're not even learning from the real about the real lessons from Afghanistan, and under this mantra of, you know, ending endless wars. But of course, as we know, wars don't end when one party disengages. And I think the Afghan war is just entering a new, actually more dangerous phase with, you know, with the refugees and the horrible humanitarian crisis there. But yeah, but as you're alluding to, you know, that's tied to a security threat associated with jihadist terrorism, which hasn't gone away. You know, so I, thank you for your leadership and your service there and the sacrifice of your soldiers. You know, I thought maybe we could end with an easy question, right? We're both familiar with heavy metal in the form of armored vehicles and tanks. But, you know, I know you have a grueling job and schedule, I think that you also are familiar with another kind of heavy metal music, which gets you motivated. So
oh, yeah, it is.
I wonder if you might share your thoughts on the connection between armored warfare and heavy metal music and what you listen to get yourself motivated.
So mostly, mostly I'm listening to Iron Maiden, but you, of course, Metallica is my favorite one. So probably it's a kind of an energy, something which is not possible to explain. I always say we have two kinds of soldiers, those that serve in the cavalry and those that really want to be part of our family. So, but I think it is not end of the typical conventional armor units or capabilities. We still, in the end of the day, needs 50 or 70 tons something to present our determination. It's a matter of composition, of course. You know, blue force trackers, systems, situational awareness, technology matters. But the most important, what I'm always saying, most important, is something in your mind and in your heart. So I'm sometimes calling my soldiers digital cavalry. It means you are digital in your capability to use new technology, but your heart is still cavalry. It means, you know, quick decisions, the brave approach, good tactics, and patriotism. So composition of heart and mind is still critical. And of course, with some kind of good heavy metal music.
Right after the Battle 73 Easting, yeah, we had these new things called Walkmans, right? Where you could play tapes, right? And one of my platoon sergeants came up and he said, "Hey, you have to listen to this song. It just come out, Thunderstruck, if you remember that song."
Absolutely. It's absolutely well known.
And he said, "This is what we did. This is what we did yesterday." It evoked kind of the, you know, at least that proximate, you know, memory of the battle the day before. But I do thank you so much. I'll tell you, General Andrzejczak, you've given us a lot to think about in terms of the current situation in Europe, what the Polish armed forces are doing, and you're reminding us of the long alliance we've had with Poland going back to the days of our revolution. And I can't thank you enough. Anything you'd like to say in conclusion before we sign off here?
Well, the living in Poland is full of challenges, historically, geographically, and many other points. But the most important is the feeling of being a member of a good family. And I met many American generals and officers, some of them colonels. Now they, have promotion and they one, two, three, or four stars. So it's very, very good family of good patriots and good warriors. So in this family, we feel safer. Please say for any of good friends of mine in the U.S. that they have friends in Poland, and I still believe our deterrence and defense will be enough to solve the problems. But if not, we will present anything we present the last 1,000 years in the history of Poland. So we're going to defend Poland absolutely.
Andrzejczak, on behalf of the Hoover Institution, thank you for helping us learn more about battlegrounds important to building a future of peace and prosperity for generations to come. It was great to see you. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you very much.
Battlegrounds is a production of the Hoover Institution, where we advance ideas that define a free society. For more information about our work, to hear more of our podcasts, or view our video content, please visit hoover.org.